and good morning. It is so great to see you here today. Our opening song, Come As You Are, is comforting reassurance that our burdens in life are not just ours to carry, that God is there and loves us unconditionally. Let's sing, Come As You Are.
You do not know. Come, you hungry for justice, aching for heaven on earth. Come, you who can toss aside, don't remember what you're worth.
Come as you are, are you weary? Come and lay your burdens down. Come as you are, bring your hopes, bring your doubts and your scars. Come as you are. Come, you who've been cast out, all you who've been shamed. Come, you who are looking for that mystery you can
sinners and saints, all you broken and needy, weird and weary and faint, all who seek to simply open their eyes, all who need to find a safe place to cry.
Come as you are, are you weary? Come and lay your burden.
Good morning. Welcome to this place of worship. I hope that you start your week out with Christ and you're able to have that follow you all the way through your week. It's wonderful to have you here. If you're a guest this morning, a special welcome to you. And if you're worshiping online, welcome. If you are a guest this morning, please know that there's a guest card in the seat back in front of you somewhere. And I invite you to sign that. Fill that out and return to the welcome window, which is across the way, for a gift in exchange for that card at the conclusion of worship. Also know that you're welcome to participate in all aspects of the service, which include communion. And so for that, you're welcome to come up by the center aisle, receive an empty cup if you prefer wine, a filled cup that has grape juice, and the bread is gluten-free, and then go back to your seat by the side aisle. There's also the opportunity to fill out a prayer card. Those are also in the seat backs in front of you. And that's if you'd like a prayer for yourself or for anyone. Just fill that out, put that in the offering basket, and we'll get that in play. At the conclusion of worship, up here by the choir chairs, there will be Sal. He's going to be up there to receive prayers if you would like prayers spoken for you or for someone else as well. That's after the worship service. And then looking ahead, just real quickly, we've been mentioning Disciples' Journey for the last few weeks. That's coming up on the 30th of this month. And if you're interested in being part of that six-week class, please sign up at the information desk so that enough materials can be provided for you. Next Sunday is our annual meeting, the once-a-year meeting of the congregation, where we look back upon the year and look forward to the year ahead as a congregation. And that will take place in Luther Hall following the second service next Sunday. So keep that in mind on your calendars that follows the service. So stay a little longer. And then on the 3rd of February, annual reports. Thank you, Joe. Annual reports, if you didn't get one in your email box, there are some hard copies in the foyer underneath the TV. You can pick one up and peruse it prior to the meeting next week. And then coming up in February on the 3rd, this again we've been announcing for a few weeks, this is Clean the World, intergenerational opportunity for you to go to Las Vegas and sort some soaps. There's a sign up at the information desk for that as well, and I encourage you to do it. It's a wonderful serving opportunity for you and your friends. And then beginning this Sunday and for the next few Sundays, we're going to be putting out some bins in the foyer for Super Bowl of Caring. Super Bowl of Caring is an opportunity for us to put soups, just soups, into the bins for the Utah Food Bank to receive. And you can't miss it. In the foyer, there are some bins with goalposts, and that's where you'll put your food. On the 11th of February, which is Super Bowl Sunday, we will be decorating them in festive colors as the teams provide. And we'll be doing a jersey Sunday, that same Sunday. So if you have a sports jersey you'd like to wear, whether they're in the game or not, you can bring and wear that Sunday as well. We're going to have some fun with this. So bring your soups. I know we just finished Christmas, but Lent is right around the corner. And it begins on Ash Wednesday, which is also Valentine's Day. You figured that one out real quick. So for worship that day, there will be a noon service here in this space. 6 o'clock worship in Luther Hall, or worship soup in Luther Hall, and then worship here at 7. That evening schedule of 6 and 7 will continue throughout the season of Lent. On Wednesdays, there will be soup and there will be worship. So if you want to keep that as a regular pattern for yourself throughout the season, that'd be great. That begins on Ash Wednesday. We're also going to be in the community with ashes again this year, giving ashes out to those in the community. So that is kind of a cool thing we're doing this year. If you are coming to the Ash Wednesday service, and the soup in particular, there's a sign up at the information desk for bringing your soups. We love to have a variety. So if you have specialty, please let us know that you're willing to share some of that, what it is, and if you don't do soups but you desserts, do sign up for that as well. That would be wonderful. And that's it for our parish notes. I invite you to stand as you are able and face the font for confession.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, creator of darkness and light, word and truth, wind sweeping over the waters. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. We pause to remember those things for which we need forgiveness. God, our rock and refuge, we pour out our hearts before you. We have known you, but have not always loved you. We have wounded one another and sinned against you. We have not always recognized the Holy Spirit dwelling in each of us. Forgive us, restore us, that we might proclaim your good news to all. Amen. The voice of the Lord is upon the water. God has spoken. The time of grace is now. In Jesus, the reign of God has come near. By the authority of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are God's beloved. Amen.
We come before God possessed by many things. Fear, shame, greed, these and more plague us. We come before God asking for healing and wholeness. Jesus casts out our demons and makes us new. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Let us pray. God, healer of mind and body, we sometimes suffer at the hands of physical, mental, and spiritual ailments. Quiet our minds, still our hearts, and empower our bodies so that we may be whole and healed. Amen. Please read responsively from Psalm 89. I will sing of your steadfast love, O Lord, forever. With my mouth, I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations. I declare that your steadfast love is established forever. Your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. You said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to my servant David. I will establish your descendants forever and be your throne for all generations. A reading from Mark chapter 5. They came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gerasenes. And when he had stepped out of the boat, immediately a man out of the tombs with an unclean spirit met him. He lived among the tombs, and no one could restrain him anymore, even with a chain. For he had often been restrained with shackles and chains, but the chains he wrenched apart, and the shackles he broke in pieces, and no one had the strength to subdue him. Night and day, among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always howling and bruising himself with stones. When he saw Jesus from a distance, he ran and bowed down before him. And he shouted at the top of his voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure you by God, do not torment me." For he had said to him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." Then Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" He replied, "My name is Legion, for we are many." He begged him earnestly not to send them out of the country. Now there on a hillside, a great herd of swine was feeding. And the unclean spirits begged him, "Send us into the swine, let us enter them." So he gave them permission. And the unclean spirits came out and entered the swine. And the herd, numbering about 2,000, rushed into the deep bank into the sea and were drowned in the sea. The swineherds ran off and told it in the city and in the country. Then people came to see what it was that had happened. They came to Jesus and saw the demonic sitting there, clothed and in his right mind, the very man who had had the legion, and they were afraid. Those who had seen what had happened to the demonic and to the swine reported it. Then they began to beg Jesus to leave their neighborhood. As he was getting into the boat, the man who had been possessed by the demons begged him that he might be with him. But Jesus refused, and he said to him, "Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and what mercy he has shown you." And he went away and began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him. And everyone was amazed. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Jesus.
At this time, I'd like to invite the children to come on up. Come on up. Good morning. You're kind of tired. I didn't get much of a good morning from you. Good morning. That's better. Thank you. I need your help this morning. It was Friday before Third Friday event, and I was working in the kitchen here at church, and I hurt myself. And it still hurts. What do you think I should do? How should I go about curing this? What's an idea? Neosporin and a Band-Aid? Sounds like a pretty good plan, don't you think? Would that hurt you if you had that? Yeah. Just so happens, I have Neosporin and a Band-Aid. Look at that. So, would you do the honors, Miss Miriam? Would you be my nurse? When we think of the gospel lesson today, and Jesus curing somebody of what ailed them, did they mention Band-Aids in the lesson? No. They didn't have Band-Aids back then. No, they didn't have Band-Aids back then. What did Jesus do to heal this guy? Yeah, he used his voice, his words, and probably a little love included. Does mom or dad ever kiss it and make it better? Or is that like a thing of the past? Okay. Well, that's using a little love to make it better. And in the story today, Jesus cured this guy of something that was really bothering him for a long time. You guys ever have that kind of feeling like the thing that was worrying me is now gone? Bennett, yes. Ashlyn, yes. Chase, yes. And that happens. We worry about something or something bothers us for a long period of time, and then something happens. Maybe it's forgiveness. Maybe it's love shown. And it goes away. We're cured of that thing. It's not a Band-Aid, but we find it healed. We are healed because of it. Isn't that awesome? That a word of forgiveness or a word of love, kiss it, make it better, it serves to heal what has been hurt. I hope that we can remember that that is what Jesus does for us, but then also commit to do that for others. A reminder will be for you to take a Band-Aid. You can wear it, or you can just hold it, take one and pass it on. And you can take one out, yeah. Take two, there's a bunch there. Maybe share one with a friend who's hurting, right? Okay, and then we'll stand and have a prayer. You want me to reach one for you? I can reach one out of the box for you. All right, I'll help you out. That's what friends are for. There you go. Okay, let's have a prayer. Can I give you my garbage? Thank you. I don't have a pocket. All right, let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, for sending your word into our hearts to heal our every ill, to cure us of that which pains us. We give you thanks for this, and may we be the same for others. In your name we pray. Amen. Thanks.
Well, hello. I want to start by asking you a question. And don't worry, you don't have to answer out loud, but whenever you hear these stories of Jesus casting out demons, is there something in you that feels ever so slightly skeptical? You know? Like demons? Really? We live in an age of science. We live in a world of advanced technology. We can send people to the moon. We can plumb the depths of the ocean. We can split atoms, cure diseases, communicate instantaneously across thousands of miles. Surely we're not going to be so foolish as to believe in demons. Surely we've advanced well beyond that, haven't we? And indeed, many folks, even fellow Christians in secular Western cultures, find these stories a little, I don't know, embarrassing. Maybe sometimes we feel like we have to apologize for them or weasel out of them, like, you know, oh man, if only Jesus had had access to the DSM-5. Then he would have known that there aren't honest-to-gosh demons, but there are mental illnesses and mood disorders. But fortunately, we know better. We now know from our enlightened scientific vantage point that we don't have to resort to abracadabras and presto changos. There aren't demons. There are problems that can be fixed with therapy and mindfulness meditation and anti-anxiety meds, right? So let me pause right here. I am someone who has benefited greatly from therapy, mindfulness meditation, and anti-anxiety medication. I'm a huge advocate of such things, and it's something I talk about openly because there are stigmas about mental health in the church, and there shouldn't be. Being depressed or anxious or having any number of mental health concerns isn't something we need to be ashamed of. It's not something we need to hide or pretend doesn't exist. It's something that many, many people deal with. And it's good and healthy to say so out loud. Which is why I actually don't think that's what's going on in these ever so difficult to explain stories about Jesus casting out demons. Now, okay, back then they might not have had the same words and scientific frameworks that we use to describe such things, but they weren't benighted bumpkins, right? They were human beings. They knew the difference between someone who was depressed or distressed and someone who lived in a cemetery, surrounded by the trappings of death and decay, seemingly beyond the grasp of reason and hope. They knew that the man in our gospel for today was dealing with something above and beyond the ordinary struggles of daily life, that indeed he was dealing with forces beyond his control. It's the kind of thing about which we read in Ephesians 6, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this world's darkness, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. In other words, as hard as it may be to believe in our secular Western context, there are spiritual elements that we can't see, but that are active and real and stand in opposition to God, and sometimes we get caught up with them. Now, before I go any further, I want to offer one more caveat. In our Bible study on Tuesday, as we read this text together, we wrestled with some pretty natural questions that the text kind of forces you to ask, right? Like, what is a demon? Why did the demons ask to go into the pigs? Or what precisely is the nature of spiritual evil? And the reality is that the text doesn't say. And furthermore, I want to suggest that we probably shouldn't spend a whole lot of time trying to figure that out. Nowhere in Scripture do we get like the precise metaphysical composition of the powers and principalities that fight against God. It's merely acknowledged that they're there. And though some throughout the history of the church have attempted to piece together a coherent narrative of the devil's origins from snippets of verses here and there, you know, there actually isn't a comprehensive story of Satan in the Bible like there is of, say, Moses or David or Jesus. I think that's a good thing. And I would caution against paying too much attention to anyone who claims otherwise. I think God would much prefer that we spend more time contemplating the nature of his magnificent love than trying to say, I don't know, sequence the genome of the demonic. You know? Does that make sense? All right. So instead of getting super bogged down in exactly what these powers are, I think this text is asking us to consider who has authority over them. The text tells us that no one could control the man who was possessed by these powers. It says no one could restrain him anymore, even with a chain. For he'd often been restrained with shackles and chains, but the chains he wrenched apart, and the shackles he broke in pieces, and no one had the strength to subdue him. And he also could not restrain himself. Night and day among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always howling and bruising himself with stones. Now that can't be something he wanted to do, right? But there he was, seemingly powerless to stop doing it. It reminds me a little bit of Paul's lament in Romans 7. I do not understand what I do, he says. For what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. Does that sound familiar? Can you relate to it? I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. He continues, for I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this is what I keep on doing. Now, if what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. In other words, Paul here is admitting that he, and indeed we all, are captive to forces beyond our control. And just because the ways in which our captivity manifests aren't always as visible and dramatic as the man's in the story, doesn't mean our predicament is any less dangerous. In fact, sometimes I wonder if the subtle ways we find ourselves ensnared aren't more dangerous, because they're insidious. If we can't see it, we can convince ourselves that everything's fine. Worse yet, we can deceive ourselves into thinking that what's evil isn't evil at all, but it's normal or necessary or, God forbid, righteous. I fear we may be far more enthralled to these powers and principalities than we want to let on. Because when we're honest about it, I think we can see them everywhere. We see them in our social media feeds, with the vitriol and anger and dehumanization. We see them in wars and violence and threats of violence between nations and between neighbors. We see them in the lies we tell about who is good and who is bad and who is in and who is out and who is human and who is less than human, whether it is others we regard with such hatred or whether it is ourselves. Worst of all, we see them in our own hearts. At least I do. For what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate, I do. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this is what I keep on doing over and over and over again. You see, we cannot overcome these forces on our own. We are not powerful enough. But do you know who is? Jesus. Jesus has power over sin, death, and the devil. Jesus has authority over all. So what are we to do in the face of our own powerlessness? We are to run. Run to Jesus Christ. Even when it is the last thing we want to do. In the passage in Mark, the unclean spirits cry out to Jesus, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, O Holy One of God." And I find myself saying that. I admit it. I find myself saying that too. No, I know who you are, and I know what you want from me, Jesus, and I don't want to give it up. Have you come to destroy me? What have you to do with me, Jesus of Nazareth? Leave me alone. But Jesus comes close to us. Jesus doesn't leave us in the graveyards of our own deception, like the man in the story who wandered in the cemetery for so long all by himself. Jesus puts his hands on us. Jesus rebukes the unclean spirits and the sin that lives in us and says, "Be silent and come out of them." And I wish I could say that that doesn't hurt. But it does hurt. It hurts like hell. I mean that literally. It hurts like hell, working its way out of us, because that is precisely what is happening. The breaking down of our sin, the replacing of the lies we cling to with the truth of God, the victory of the love and holiness of Jesus over the powers and principalities of this world, it is not a cakewalk. When the demonic spirits go, they convulse and they cry, the agony of falsehood being destroyed. And yet, like the man in the story, we will find ourselves in our right minds, human at last, healed and whole. This is the authority that Jesus has over every sin, over every falsehood, over every demon and unclean spirit. And what you must always remember is that it is already done. He has already accomplished it. In the cross and resurrection of Christ, the outcome is already assured. God will triumph, and so therefore will you. And this assurance is given to us as a gift in the declaration of the forgiveness of sin, and in the waters of baptism, and in the bread and wine of the communion table. So I want you to know, today, right here, right now, that there is nothing you have done or have left undone that is beyond the divine healing of Jesus Christ. Whatever demons are tormenting you, whatever sin is living in you, whatever unclean spirits are troubling you, receive this word. Be silent and come out. By the authority of Jesus Christ, you are whole and forgiven. Now go out from here to your friends, to your family, to your community, and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and what mercy he has shown you. Tell them so that God can do for them what he has already done for you. Amen. Let's stand as we sing.
Precious Lord.
Precious Lord, you have lived
I invite you to profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Trusting in the good news of Jesus Christ, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. You reached out to a man whose behavior was frightening to so many, restoring him to wholeness. Push through our discomfort with others' challenges, that we might extend love and grace to all who need it. God, our teacher and healer, in mercy, hear our prayer. Your miraculous creation is at the same time both strong and delicate. Help us to appreciate its bold beauty while working to ensure the balance it needs to thrive. God, our teacher and healer, in mercy, hear our prayer. Strengthen all those who work tirelessly to change systems and policies that marginalize those with mental illness or developmental disabilities. Guide our leaders to proclaim a message of inclusivity for all people. God, our teacher and healer, in mercy hear our prayer. Cast out all those things we cling to or which cling to us that deprive us of healthy, full lives. Bring wholeness to all who suffer. We also pray for those in promising news who have asked for prayer. Prayers from the congregation are now invited either aloud or from your hearts. God, our teacher and healer, in mercy hear our prayer. We remember each day that 9 million children in the United States regularly do not have enough food to foster healthy growth and development. in your name, help us to do our part to end food insecurity in one of the world's most wealthiest nations. God, our teacher and healer, mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, give us the insight and strength to follow your Holy Spirit, leading us to help others and spread your good news. God, our teacher and healer, in mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our military. May God bless them and keep them, and may they feel your presence all around them. May they find his blessings in whatever they are set out to do. May God fill their heart with the gratitude of a grateful nation. God, our teacher and healer, in mercy, hear our prayer. We remember all your saints who overcame challenges and even tragedy and credited their enduring faith in you. Let their example inspire that same faith in us as we navigate the pains and trials of everyday life. God, our teacher and healer, in mercy hear our prayer. Confident that in Christ Jesus you answer prayer, we lift to you all for whom we pray aloud and in our hearts, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. In the peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Please share that sign of peace with your neighbors. All peace to you.
I invite you to rise to bring forth our gifts and offerings.
Oh,
Let us pray. Holy God, we offer now our gifts and our tithes out of what you have generously given to us. Use them for the sake of all who suffer, that the world might know your healing love. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, for in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the power of the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Jesus, who frees us from all our demons through his holy body and blood, now invites you to the table of healing and wholeness in his name. Come and eat, for all is prepared. I invite those of you who are with us here in the sanctuary to please be seated.
Thank you.
Now that we've been fed with the body and blood of Christ, let's all stand and sing, "Go Make Disciples."
Pray. Giver of every gift, Christ's body is our food, and we are Christ's body. Raise us to new life by your power, for the benefit of all, and to your glory, now and forever. Amen. Receive this blessing. May the blessing of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit keep and preserve you now and always.
I danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun, and I came down from heaven and I danced on the earth, and at the end I am dancing around the unity. I am the Lord and the dance that he and I'll lead you all.
Our God's beloved, thanks be to God.